let's start with Mura. Now, what is Mura? Mura is a Japanese term for unevenness, okay? So, you know, standardized work is the foundation of the TPS system. That is the foundation of lean. Fine. So, this means if your resources are being overburdened or they are underutilized, this means you are in a state of Mura. And that's not a very good state to be in, because ultimately all this would lead to Mura waste. Fine. So, unevenness, irregularity, lack of uniformity, non-uniformity, inequality, all these terms suggest that this is Mura. Inconsistent or uneven application of time and resources across a process. That is when you are not consistent how you're using your time and resources across the process. This means that you are in a state of Mura, because you are not using them consistently. Actually, lean says that nothing should be overburdened and nothing should be underutilized. But since you are inconsistent, that this means you are overburdening your manpower, overburdening your machinery, or you are underutilizing the skills of the people around or the machinery. So, conjunction, that is the connection of overburdening some resources while others wait, or of alternating over time between overburdening and underutilizing the same resources. So, basic thing I want to say is that sometimes what happens is that you just overburden certain resources and some are waiting to be utilized, or it's an alternating cycle which goes on. So, what happens is that people are not comfortable in such environments, machineries go through wear and tear, and your processes are not effective and efficient, to say the least. A typical prerequisite of our unevenness is the inability to smooth out your processes and create a balance check. That means that if you want to see that how Mura is, this means that you are not able to smooth out your processes. That is, your flow is not smooth. Some people are overburdened, they are working, and some are sitting idle because they are just waiting for something. Some machines are working overtime and some are not being used. So, this is the prerequisite. And then this means that you are in a state of Mura, or you are creating Mura. Fine. As a result, stream try to process as fast as they can. So, what happens is that when there is Mura in the system, there is inconsistent workflow. So, teams try to process as fast as they can and in large batches. Fine. One after another, with little thought of how processes will handle the burden, due to which processes become less predictable and teams struggle to deliver value at a steady pace. Obviously, when your teams don't know that what kind of things are happening in the system, when the system is overburdened and when it is not. So, what happens is that flow is not steady. This means the flow of value is not steady. Your processes are not stable. You don't know what kind of output to expect. And then, obviously, in such a system, when people are overburdened, there are chances of defects that would happen into your products and services. So, basically, what happens is that you are not able to deliver value at a steady pace. And this is very important when we are talking about lean. So, unevenness can be found in fluctuations in customer demand. Now, obviously, unevenness is everywhere. Your customer demands are not stable and you cannot control that. Process times per product or variation of cycle times for different operators, all these are different. But actually, what you need to do is you need to understand the basic underlying pattern and then create your processes according to that. In production environment with low volume, high product variation, flexibility is more important. When you are in a production environment where you need low volume, but the product variation is high, this means you need lot of flexibility. And in contrast, if it's more important, if it's in high volume product, you need a product in high volumes and there is no variation. Okay, so then what happens is that you don't need flexibility. So ideally, what I'm trying to explain is that you have to understand your processes. What are they like? What is the baseline? How they are working? What is the demand of the customer and how it fluctuates? So you need to gather data around it and then you need to create your processes. If Mura is not reduced, this means if this unevenness is not controlled, it leads to increased chances of Muri. So what will happen? You will start overburdening your processes, your people, your system, your machines, and this will ultimately lead to defects, Mura. Before improving a system, if you're trying to improve a system, like if you're trying to implement lean, so before improving a system, it is essential to first create stability, that is, remove this Mura, create stability, attaining basic stability in the 4 M's. Now, what is this 4 M? This is men, machine, material and method. That is that if you're trying to implement lean, you're trying to remove the defects from your system, first attain stability at the basic level, that is 4 M's, that are men, machine, material and method. If you've done that, then start working further. This is essential for sustained reduction in Mura, because otherwise you won't be able to sustain and reduce the Mura in the system. Because without basic stability, there will be Mura due to variance. Because if variation is there and you're not understanding your process cycles and overburdening is there and irregularity is there, so Mura will stay in the system and which will ultimately convert to Mura. So general rule is best to work on Mura first. So when we talk about lean implementation, first thing that is suggested is that first work on Mura, that is try to control this unevenness, make your processes more stable, create a predictable level of flow in your business, as this will highlight present unreasonableness in the system. Because once you understand what are the customer demands, how your systems work, how your production levels are, you know, there is a basic understanding of each of these facts. Even though you think that no, this is impossible, you can understand. If you start collecting data, if you start collecting figures, you will see, you will find a common connect where you can see that how you can reduce Mura. So simple rule is, without tackling Mura and Muri, that is if you are not able to control Mura and Muri, Mura will be there, that is defects will be there in the system and they will haunt you forever. So if I have to give you an example of Mura, customer demand can appear to be erratic. Now, when we talk about customer demand, so they can be erratic, fine. But often there is an underlining pattern that can be identified. As I told you, that there is always a pattern. How your processes are, what you do, there is always an underlining pattern. That's why there are so many tools today. When we talk about websites, if I can give you an example, what is Google Analytics? When we talk about YouTube, what is analytics? Actually, there are these graphs and everything which show you some kind of pattern. You can check that from which countries your maximum customers are coming, or from on which page they are landing, okay, and what are the high times and what are the low times. For example, in YouTube, you can check that when is the highest time that peak of your viewers are viewing your videos, or the days on which they watch it on max time, right? So all this, you can always, what I'm trying to suggest is that whatever your work is, whether it's production, whether it's services, anything, you can always find an underlining pattern. And the people and the managers, process owners who understand this underlining pattern, they can control Mura. So here in this example, we may find that our customer demand is of 2000 products on Mondays and Tuesdays, which goes down to 1500 on Wednesdays and Thursdays, and it just slashes down to 500 on Friday, right? So what we see is that our operators are rushing on Mondays and Tuesdays, they are working very hard, off their toes, and on Fridays they do not have any kind of work, fine. So this phenomena is not good for people in production to have such highs and troughs in their like working in the demand, because you know what, they are not able to understand that on Mondays and Tuesdays they are working so much, so they may be creating lot of waste, and on Fridays they don't have work. So if there is an underlining pattern and you understand, so what a good process owner or manager will do is that he would endeavor that they should level out the production and run at 1500 parts in average throughout the week. So this would happen is that everybody would know that we have to create 1500 products throughout the week. So this will level out the production, this will level out the processes, they would better understand their processes, they would have the time to think over how to improve their processes. So continuing with the example where we saw that the company was having an uneven production system, because the employees were overworked in the first two days of the week, they were making 2000 products, and gradually until when they reached Friday, it was the demand was only of 500 products, right? So what this clearly states is that first thing, the company is not collecting any data, any facts or figures of what actually is the customer demand, and even if they are collecting, nobody is analyzing that properly. If they would have done that, if they would have analyzed that, they would have understood that what kind of flow is required, that how many products are need to be made each day so that the flow is even. We can reduce Mura. Fine, Mura is what? Unevenness. So basically, if they would understood, they would have got one number which would have been sufficient. Like you can make 1500 products per day, and then till Monday to Friday, everybody would be doing equal amount of work, nobody's skills, nobody is just sitting idle, or nobody is overworked. Fine. So this is the only way where you can understand what your figures say, what your figures are trying to tell, what your data is trying to tell, and this is the need. Actually, you have to understand the requirements first. Fine. So this company had measures which drive uneven production. So we understand that since they have like so many high peaks, like a few days they have to make 2000 products, and certain days they just have to make 500 products. So they have uneven production. So we got that point. So this is famously known as a hockey stick graph. It is most obvious representation of Mura. So whenever we need to represent Mura in any form of process, in any production or in service, we use a hockey stick effect diagram. So I won't be going in detail of what is hockey stick. I would be giving you a brief of that here. I have already mentioned it so that you understand the basic concept, but the detail is not in your syllabus. Fine. So as I told you, hockey stick is an obvious representation of Mura. So this is the best way to understand. This hockey stick gives you the idea that this company has lots and lots of Mura. They don't have even flow. So an alternative where everyone works like an atmosphere where everyone works like crazy in final week of the month, depleting every sub-assembly and production part that you have to get the numbers out before the end of the month. So the companies which don't understand the concept of Mura, who do not have an even workflow, who don't work on the pull of the customer, that is when they only make products when the demand is there. So what happens is that they're just focusing on numbers, that we need to produce. Okay, I may be taking an example of a car manufacturer. Okay, so it's just a small facility and they have this target that we have to make 500 cars at the end of the month. So this is the only focus they are having. They are not understanding what customer demand is and where this customer demand is at peak and when it's not, so that they can just make the flow even. They're only working on one final number, and by doing this, what they are actually doing is they are working in an atmosphere where they are depleting their resources, that is every sub-assembly and production part. So everything is overworked. When things are overworked, what would happen is that first thing is that wear and tear. Second thing, your quality would go down because you're only focused, instead of focusing on quality, instead of focusing on waste removal, your focus is to just fix, like just to get that number that, okay, we need 500 cars and we are making 500 cars. How they are made, how actually everything is going on, what kind of waste we are producing while doing that, nobody is bothered. Fine. So this is what Mura is. In such situations, little thought is given to actual customer demands. So already told you. So if the company is working like this, what happens is that they are not giving any, like they are not giving any importance whatsoever to what is actually the customer demand is. Fine. So I think so from the beginning of this course, I've told you that if you are working on Lean Six Sigma, that company would only make products on the pull of the customer, that the customer demand is there. So then they will assemble and give it to them. Fine. So this actually little thought is given on the customer demand. These are the companies that have the maximum Mura. They just need to get as many parts finished as possible so that the targets for the month are met. So the only thing they focus is on the target for the month. Fine. So it's required, not required is not bothering anybody. Nobody is thinking about that. So what happens in such situations is that in the first week of month, obviously when you're just focusing on your targets in the month end, then what happens is you have just utilized all your resources, everything. So what happens is in the first week of the month is then very slow as sub-assemblies and supplied parts have been depleted because you have just depleted most of your resources. So your functions just go very slow. So now what happens is that first you were overburdening the things, and now you have come in a phase where everything is underutilized and supplied parts have been depleted, and it takes time to build up the production rate again into the month. So what will happen is that first they will be going like this, underutilizing everything, and suddenly you will see that they will again be just focusing on meeting those targets again. So that's why it's called a hockey stick, because it forms, see, if you just look here, so it's just something like that. It makes a figure of a hockey stick. So this is not only the problem with the manufacturing departments or the manufacturing sector. Fine, this is same issue is with seen with the service industries. For example, a consultant works hard at its manufacturing and networking to build up some business. Fine, so he's working very hard to get maximum number of customers. He's networking. Maybe he's using those. We have lots of sites for networking nowadays. We can use Facebook, LinkedIn, and all that to build up some business. But then finds himself working hard facing customers every day, and what is actually happened is that his product is not ready, but he has just built those number of customers, he has built those links, and he's finding how to serve them. But then what actually happens is that when the product actually gets ready, he runs out of those customers. So this is also a what we call as a hockey stick effect, that is unevenness in your products, in your services. And until and unless we are able to remove this unevenness, we cannot focus on actually eliminating the actual Mura, the 8 kinds of defects. Fine. So, as I told you that I'll just give you a brief of what actually is a hockey stick so that you understand what is a hockey stick effect. So, the hockey stick effect is characterized by a sharp rise or fall of data points after a long flat period. So, here what you can see is that this is here the number of machines which are assembled per week. So, this is hockey stick effect, and this is not like what they assemble per week. So this is week 1, week 2, week 3, week 4. So what you can see is that in the first week they are not assembling like as much as they should be doing, because what should happen if they are working according to Lean is that something should be like this. So for all the weeks they should have equal amount of work, week 1, week 2, week 3, week 4. But here what you can see is that week 1, not much number of products are just assembled, not much machines are being assembled, and then week 2, this figure just rises little high, and then week 3 it goes high, and suddenly in week 4 you see a sharp rise. Fine. So this is how the hockey stick looks like. Fine. So that's why it's called a hockey stick effect. And again, then you see that it just falls down. See, in week 1 again, then the numbers are so less, and then again it's rising. So the trend is like this, fine. So the hockey stick effect is characterized by a sharp rise or fall of data points after a long flat period. So this is the flat period, and suddenly you will see, boom, the data is rising. They are manufacturing lots of, they are assembling lot of machines suddenly in the last week. Why? Just to meet certain targets. That is the numbers. Illustrating using the graphical shape of line chart, so this is a line chart that resembles a hockey stick, as I've already told you. Hockey stick chart formation illustrates that urgent action may be required to understand the phenomena or find a solution for drastic shift in the data points. So if you see that you also have similar kind of assembly lines, or you also have similar kind of data, this means you need to work on Mura. This means you are not understanding what the customer demand is. You are not understanding the capability of your machines and your manpower. You are not understanding anything. So what you first thing you have to understand is that what is the maximum number of products that can be manufactured per week, assembled per week, or services you can provide per day, right? So when you understand that, what is the max level without overburdening or underutilizing? So understand that max level, then relate that maximum level to the customer demand. That is, what is the actual customer demand, and when actually customer demands this product, fine. So correlate these things so that you don't see such kinds of graphs in your production lines or in your services. So when a hockey stick effect occurs, the majority of revenue of a company are concentrated in the last part of the period. So what happens is that here you are just wasting your capacity. See, wasted assembly capacity. So here your everything, your people, your machines, they are not being utilized fully. And here your entire thing is being overworked. They are overburdened. People will be overburdened. Machines will be overworked. So actually not thinking about quality at all, because they are just focusing on numbers. So what happens is that the complete revenue goes here. Either it's a week, it's month, or an year. All this affects on the product delivery. Obviously, if you don't have an even flow of value, if you don't have an even production system, so product delivery would be affected. Product returns, as I've told you, if Mura is there, this means quality will be low, right? So obviously you will have to face product returns, warranty cost. I can just go on and on, but I don't want to stretch this topic. So I believe that you've understood what actually this hockey stick effect is. So now that you have started understanding Mura, it's very important you understand what are the causes of Mura. Most of them I have already talked about. First one is that uneven customer demand. So customer demands are always uneven. No company is anytime sure that this is that this would be the demand of the customer. So it's always irregular until and unless you are in with agreement with certain company that asks you to deliver that number of parts per month, fine, or per week. So this is something which is common and which we have to deal with by understanding. That's why I told you that we need to collect information about it. So then comes inventory swings. That is, either your inventory is too low or you are having too high inventory. When it's too low, this means your production, anything is required. You need to produce a product, you need to build up a service. If you don't have much inventory, again, that would be slow. And if you, sometimes what happens is that you have too much of inventory and you start making products very quickly, and then again this slope comes. Fine, so this inventory swings. Uneven production speed or changing production quantities. That is, your production speed is not even. That is, what are the maximum number of products you are producing or the services you are delivering. It's uneven, or you are changing the quantities. Fine. Uneven quality of good parts, that is, the good part quality is not even. Irregular or erratic working rhythm, that is, the rhythm by which the work is done each day, each week, each month, it doesn't have any rhythm. There is no standardized work, it's erratic. uneven training of the workers, your workers are not trained, and then uneven distribution of the workload. Obviously, if few people or machines are overworked and some are not, they are not being used optimally, so it is going to cause Mura. So these are few very basic causes of Mura. Now, now we understand what Mura is, what causes Mura. So now it's time that we need to understand how to identify Mura, fine? So there are two major ways to identify unevenness in your process by applying lean. So these two ways are visualizing your workflow on a Kanban board, that you visualize the complete workflow and you do that on a Kanban board. Another one is measuring your process stability with cumulative flow diagrams. So first we will discuss visualizing the workflow with Kanban. So this is the first logical step for spotting unevenness in your processes. That is, if you want to see that if there is Mura in your processes, the first thing is that you need a Kanban board where you can visualize your entire process. So this is a lean tool used, to identify Mura is the Kanban method. It allows you to map your workflow on a board divided by columns. That is, each step is divided, like you have your Kanban board, then you divide the board into columns so that each column represents each step of your process. Then the more detailed you build it, obviously the more details you will put in, the more comprehensive understanding you will have, better understanding you will have of the amount of Mura you have got in the process. So the more details you put in will give you more details, and you will have better understanding that if there is Mura in process, how much is there, how you can tackle it. When each task is hosted on the Kanban card, you can clearly see how much work is in progress and where it gets stuck. So basically, when you're visualizing your task, as I told you, this will give you a clear picture that how your work in progress is, how the flow of your work is, and where it's getting stuck. As a result, you will be able to identify problematic areas and take action to deal with the unevenness, so that you can check that what is causing this Mura unevenness and you can deal with those problematic areas. So, most powerful weapon in the Kanban arsenal for dealing with Mura is the ability to put limits on the amount of work in progress. When we talk about Kanban, you know, the most effective way we can use Kanban is to check the work in progress, that is WIP. Fine, both globally, that is throughout the process, and for any particular stage of the workflow. So if you can put those limits, that means we are only going to produce this much, or we are going to only deliver these many services for any particular area, you can do that. This helps in ensuring a steady flow of assignments and prevents unevenness. But again, I'm going to tell you that just if you're just putting the these limits on the work in progress won't help. So another tool you need is cumulative flow diagrams for optimal process stability, right? So with this lecture, I have just put a PDF image of a cumulative flow diagram because I just didn't want to draw it on board. So you just open that image and then understand what I'm saying, fine? So what you will see is that in that image, you will see that there are lot many tools available which you can use to make these cumulative flow diagrams, fine? There are softwares. So basically you add your data and then you check how, because it is something which is not regular, it's not one thing you will make. So as and whenever data is added to it, so it changes, fine? So just open it up and then listen to what I have to say. So the best way to gain a comprehensive understanding of the stability of your process is to draw a cumulative flow diagram. So basically what you will see in this image is now there would be various bands of various colors which represent different parts. So each band on the diagram is a representation of a stage in your workflow. As the bands progress over time, you need to monitor their width. So as you add in more information and your process is in progress, so you will notice that the width of these bands keep on changing, fine? So if all the bands on the cumulative flow diagram except the bottom one are progressing in a parallel way, that is their width is increasing or decreasing in an equal amount, then your progress is stable and you don't have to you don't have notable problems with Mura. So if all the bands are progressing in the same way, either their width is increasing or decreasing as you're entering more and more data, so this means your processes are stable, they don't have much Mura. So now that we understand what Mura is, we understand its causes, we know how to identify it, so it's time that we learn a little bit about how to reduce Mura, fine? So tackling Mura requires openness and cooperation in the supply chain. That is why when we were talking about identifying Mura, I told you about Kanban cards where you need to just write everything, all the process steps. So basically this is the same thing, that you require openness and cooperation in the supply chain, that is from the raw materials to how the processes move. Everything should be open and there should be collaboration. Being flexible with product design and focusing on creating standard work for all operators. So your product design should be flexible, like one part can be like, if you want to, like assembly should be such that you have various parts and that can be assembled to form different products, fine? So this is what we mean when we talk about flexibility in product design, and same is in the services thing. And focusing on creating standardized work, that is everyone should know that these are the steps we need to follow. So one thing you need to understand is that variability will always degrade performance or production of your production or your service system. If there is variability in what you are producing or what you are servicing, right, so that will degrade the complete performance. This means that you cannot expect one kind of product, like a standard product. The quality will always be up and down. And variability in system will be buffered, and it can also can be further slowed down by some combination of inventories, capacity or time. So all these things actually just cause variability, and this causes Mura. So to reduce variability, there are two key areas we need to focus on. First thing is reducing the variation in the customer demand, and second is reducing the variation in your process. So if you want to reduce this variability, we need to reduce the variation in the customer demand and your processes. And how this can be done? One is modular product design. If you've just seen the things like IKEA furniture, so they use same parts to design different kind of products. So this is what I mean by modular product design. So allow the product to be produced uniformly and put together in multiple ways. And then production leveling in production planning. So use Hijunka and other lean methods. So I will be talking about these in section 9. Then obviously building flow at the production level, that your flow should be smooth. There should be, you should check what are the problematic areas and everyone should know what they are doing. You can just put limits on the work in progress. This is how you can do. Then standardized work is very important. We have already talked about it. Reduce number of links in supply chain. That is how your supply chain is working. Reduce those links. External warehousing or moving parts of a plant is not a good idea in this service. Fine. So it's not that your warehouses should be somewhere else and lot of movement of things and parts. Reduced delivery times between the links. That is, for example, if you are producing something, so your raw materials should be available. They should be readily available. If somebody has a service processes, they should know that and delivery times should be less. What you need when you are just making a product, you are delivering a service, what you need should be there at that time. So such as possible 6 weeks of transport times are terrible for inventories and lead times in the chain. For example, if your inventories or your things need raw material will come after 6 weeks, or it takes 6 weeks of time. This is a normal example. So this can vary, but I'm just giving you examples. So these things are terrible. This will always cause Mura. To create, then you need to create transparency between links in the supply chain when it comes to orders. This will reduce the tendency to increase order size at every link. So basically, when you create the transparency in the complete value stream, each process owner knows that what they are supposed to do and how they are supposed to do. So then what happens is that the unevenness goes down, and also the tendency to produce in large batches, that also goes down, because that's not a very good idea to produce products in large batches. Fine. So example here, I'm just putting some things in perspective by giving you an example. So take an example of production leveling. Now, you don't treat every job as a sprint and try to do everything quickly. So you don't have to do everything quickly. Why? Because, you know, look at the tech time for your customer requirements. That look at the tech time, that when your customer requirements, like when your customer requires the product. If your customer wants 1200 parts per week, I'm just giving you an example so that how you can just even out your work. So if your customer wants 1200 parts per week and you have 8 hour shifts with 2400 minutes available, then you need to produce one part every 2 minutes. So things become clear. Once, that's why I told you, understand the customer demands, get the figures, connect them with your processes. So what will happen is that things will start opening up and you will understand that what you are supposed to make in what time. So basically, this 2 minutes is the tack time, and this is the heartbeat or the drum beat which your process should follow. And once you figure these things out, that what is the customer demand, and then what kind of capacities do we have and how much products we can make, then what you can decide is that how much we need to make in what amount of time. So this will automatically reduce Mura. All you need is to balance your processes so that they provide you with one part every 2 minutes. So this, if you understand what your customer demands are and what you're supposed to make, so you can balance your processes. This will keep everything moving smoothly and provide what your customer needs. So then another thing you need to understand is that every business is different. While some have seasonal demands that have to be catered for, and others have almost infinite variety of products that customers could call for. So you have, in these days, we have different kind of demands, and the customer demands always vary, and businesses are different. So as I already told you, some have seasonal demands, some may have lots of products and customer can ask for any product. So what can be done? But you, from the beginning, when I started teaching Mura, I told you that you need to find out the underlining pattern of what the customer demand is, when it is coming. And once you figure out this underlining pattern that is predictable, then you will know that what is demanded, when it is demanded, and when that demands come, and it can be used to create a basis for smooth and regular basis for your production. Fine. So if I have to summarize the complete concept of Mura, Mura is a major waste in lean management that can seriously harm your company if left unattended. So Mura is one of the main kinds of waste, because it will lead to Muri and it leads to Mura. By maintaining a stable workflow, you can achieve steadier pace of delivering finished goods to your customer, better use of your employee capacity, and more effective collaboration between teams. So if you just tackle Mura, you will tackle lot of problems which are associated with unbalanced work, how your products are being created, overworked employees, underutilized resources. So this way you can tackle lot of things. That's why it said that first thing to do is that focus on reducing Mura, then reduce Muri, and then talk about Mura.